tracking dashboard using YOLOR, DeepSort, and Streamlit. So if you don't already know, Streamlit is a way to get professional looking web apps or dashboards in which you can interact with your computer vision applications. So over here, what we have is our dashboard. It is detecting many other classes, and currently you can see that it's at a very low frame rate. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to enable GPU right over here. And you can see that it's working much faster. Over here, we're tracking the total amount of objects in the scene, and we have the width of our input resolution. We can choose to save the video if we want to. Set the confidence to maybe 1. If we put it at 1, obviously it'll be more stricter and won't detect much. If we bring it right down to 0, but not at 0, you can see that it'll be very lenient and detect quite a lot of other things. Like in this case, it was detecting a motorcycle for these two signs. And what's really cool about this application is that we can select custom classes. So in this case, we can select a person class, but I want to detect only cars, for example. So I'm going to select cars. You can see in this menu, it's got all of the 80 classes from YOLOR based on the Cocoa dataset. So if you want to detect bicycles or trucks, for example, you can select buses. And it will detect only the classes that are specified right over here. And what's really cool is that we can import any other video right over here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this sample video, drag and drop it right over here. And it'll automatically load our new video. Now it's not detecting anything because we still are filtering by class. So I'm going to change that and change it to person class. So it'll only detect people in the image. But say we want to only detect backpacks, for example. So I'm going to go down here, look for handbags. I'm going to take out the person class and maybe add in some backpacks. And this is quite useful in the case for airport security, where you don't want any handbags or luggage being left alone or unattended. So yeah, I really hope you're excited because we're going to be building this dashboard right now. This video is sponsored by Altium, the industry standard and most professional PCB design software on the market. I've used Altium for designing printed circuit boards to build my own custom Arduinos and high-speed on-edge computer vision projects. When I tested other PCB CAD softwares out there, I found that nothing came close to the flexibility, ease of use, and power of Altium Designer. I mean, if you ever worked on PCB design for computer vision applications, you know that transmitting video signals is a very delicate task, with many high-speed signals that you have to consider in terms of electromagnetic noise and crosstalk. Altium helps you to easily manage and route high-speed signals with lint tuning to ensure that you receive clear image quality on the other end. What's really great is that we have partnered up with Altium to bring you an exclusive discount for our Augmented Startups community. Sign up with the link down below to get 30% off monthly of the perpetual license of Altium Designer. You can also try out Altium Designer for free for the first 15 days. Just click the link down below to get started. Cool, so if you want to get the code for this, you can head over to the Vision Store at www.augmentedstartups.info/Vision Store, where you'll find a wide variety of projects relating to computer vision and AI. You can explore all of the other projects that we have on the Vision Store. The one that we're looking for right here is called YOLOR Streamlit Dashboard. Now, just note that this is a premium lecture, meaning that you'll have to purchase the files in order to tag along with the tutorial. However, if you want to get them cheaper, you can purchase them through the YOLOR course, where you can get all of these projects at a discounted price. So click on here to get into the project. And once you are here, you'll be greeted with this dashboard that says YOLOR Streamlit Dashboard. You can read a little bit about what we're going to do. You can watch a demo of what we will be doing in this lecture, along with all of the requirements, which are a PC or laptop, a webcam, GPU, along with Python Conda. Now, all of the files that you need is right over here. So click this to download the files. Now, the files that you download over here are exactly the same files that you'll download right over here within the course. So when you're ready, you can either download it here or over here. Let's wait for it to download and we'll get started. Great, so once it has downloaded, make sure that you've extracted it and navigate yourself into this folder. So let's just take a look at the hierarchy. So over here you can see that we've cleaned up quite a bit. So we've got our DeepSort PyTorch library. We've also segmented all of the YOLO, R, and DeepSort stuff into one script. If you open it up, you'll see that most of the functions that we use will be right over here for object detection and tracking. The reason for doing this is because our streamlit file will be nice and clean, and we can focus on only the streamlit part of it right over here. Other than that, we have our requirements.txt. We also have our sample and test videos that we can try out, as well as our YOLO R pre-trained weights. So if you haven't already, open up streamlit demo underscore base.py. So as you can see, we are starting from scratch. There's nothing else inside here. Now before we start, make sure that you have opened up terminal and you have navigated into our streamlit directory. With that, it's cd for change directory, and then paste your streamlit directory. Cool, so let's keep this one side for now. And let's start coding our streamlit user interface for YOLO R. Great, so the first thing that we need to do is to import our YOLO R script that we've created right over here. So we're going to type in from YOLO R import everything. So this will just be a star. Next, we're going to import temp file. We're going to import OpenCV, which is CV2. And then finally, we're going to import streamlit as SD. So the first thing that we need to do, as you remembered in the previous section on streamlit, we need to first define our main. So main definition is this. Put your colon. And now we start off with our title. So we're going to say sd.title. And we're going to name it object tracking dashboard for YOLO R. We're also going to go down and let's write the code that will start up our main script. So that's underscore underscore name equals equals. This is the main function. Delete that and say try. And we want to implement main. And if that does not work, we put a accept system exit. And essentially, we don't want it to do anything. We just want it to exit and not cause any issues. This is so that our app doesn't freeze up our entire computer. Okay, so let's try and see if anything works right off the bat. So right up here, we've got a command that says run streamlit.demo.py. Ours is a bit different, so we're going to say streamlit run streamlit demo underscore base.py. Let's see what we get. Cool, so as you can see, everything worked fine. Now instead of just working like this, let's go over to file and open file in project. Save that. Okay, everything looks good here. As you can see, we've imported all our libraries. We've got our main function over here and the code to execute the main function. Now let's add in some additional functionality. So we're going to add in a sidebar that'll say sd.sidebar.title. And this will say settings. We're also going to put in a markdown, like how we did before. So sd.markdown. We put parentheses over there. Enter, enter. All right, over here, we're going to put three quotation marks, right? So let's copy this and paste it right here at the bottom again to close it off. We're going to put in our style tag over here. Style, we're going to type in data dash tested, or rather test ID equals SD sidebar. We're going to close off our brackets, open brackets. We're going to put in aria dash expanded equals true. And that's greater than div. First child. Open parentheses, and we want to specify our width, 400 pixels. Put in a semicolon over there, right? And then we can close off our parentheses here. Cool, so what we're going to do now is that we're going to copy this, paste it over here. Now this will be data this ID equals SD sidebar. This will be false. We've got div first child with 400 pixels. And we also want our margin left on the left hand side. And this will be at 400 pixels, or rather minus 400 pixels. And we want to close off our style tag. So just copy that, go over here, press enter, style, and let's close off the tag. Great. Don't forget the comma over here. And then we're going to write unsafe underscore allow underscore HTML equals true, comma. Okay, let's see if this worked. Go back to your dashboard, try refreshing it. And as you can see, we have our settings pane over here. So we can close it if we don't want it, and we can conveniently open it up. So like I've mentioned in the previous section, this will give us our margin that's of 400 pixels wide and the width of our main pane. Cool, so let's focus now on the sidebar. We're going to specify our confidence. So this is the confidence that we are going to get for our YOLR object detector. So we can say confidence equals sd.sidebar.slider. So we're going to implement a slider for that. So this will say confidence. We can make this capital. And then what we're going to do is we're going to put in the minimum and maximum values. So minval or minimum value equals 0.0. And then we're going to have a max value equals 1.0. We're going to have a default value of 0.25. So let's put in also another small markdown for the sidebar. Sidebar.markdown. And we're going to just put in a divider. So this is about 1, 2, 3 of them. Let's try and run our app again. Refresh. Great. So as you can see, we've got a slider. We can scroll between 0 and 1. So obviously, if it's more towards 0, it'll be more lenient. And if you put it more towards 1, it'll be more strict with regards to the detections. We can even put a markdown up here if we wanted to. Refresh. I think that looks a little bit more neater, don't you think? Cool, so next we want to put in a couple of checkboxes. So we're going to say save underscore img equals sd.sidebar.checkbox. And this will say save video. We need another one for enabling the GPU. So copy and paste this. And let's call this enable underscore GPU. And this is equal sd.sidebar.checkbox. And we're going to change this to enable GPU. Let's refresh our dashboard again. Okay, so we've got this and that. Right now it doesn't do anything at the moment because we haven't programmed it, but let's gradually get into that. We also want to put in our custom underscore classes. So we want to specify the variety of classes that we have. And this is on a pre-trained network. So there's approximately around 80 classes if you go into the coco.names file. But obviously if you use your own dataset, it'll be different. So this is sd.sidebar. You want to put in another checkbox. Let's group these together. And then we're going to say use custom classes. So we're going to save and we're going to put in the assigned classes. So that's assigned underscore class underscore ID. This is going to become an empty list. So now that we have our list, right? If we save this and reload. So if we click this, nothing will happen. So this means we need to code in the functionality for custom classes, or rather for filtering custom classes. So we're going to say if custom classes. So that means if it's selected, then we're going to assign or assign class equals sd.sidebar.multi-select. And we're going to say select the custom classes. Let's just make this a little smaller so we can see the rest. So from here, we're going to have a list of names. And the default name that we want, or the default label, should be person, or the person class. So we can say for each in assigned class, we're going to put assigned underscore class ID dot append. And we're going to append all of the names into this list. This is names.index. Cool. Let's just refresh quickly. If we select this, you can see that we have our classes loaded up and ready. So if you want to, we can select person, we can select airplane, we can select boat. Obviously, it won't do anything right now because we are not tracking anything. So the next thing that we have to do is we need to import our file uploader. So that is video underscore file underscore buffer equals sd.sidebar.file uploader, and this will specify that we need to upload a video. And we want it to be of a specific type. It can be either MP4, MOV, AVI, ASF, and also M4V. Oops, forgot this one. Okay, so I think we've covered all of the file formats. Now this part over here, let's just label it here that we are uploading our video. So here we are uploading the videos. Here we're specifying the checkboxes. And over here, we're going to specify our custom classes. Cool, now we want to specify our demo video. So we're going to say demo video. This is the video that's going to be running on default. So we don't land up with any error. It will just start up the video straight away. So this is test.mp4. Now this corresponds to this video over here. Or if you want to run sample.mp4, that's entirely up to you. Okay. And over here, we're going to say tf fly equals temp dot named temporary file. This is temp file. Put in the suffix. This is going to be .mp4. And delete equals false. Make sure false is a capital letter, like that. Okay. And that should eliminate any errors that you get. So first up, we're going to write over here that we are going to get our input video here. So the way we go about doing that is we're going to say if not, so if there's no video file in the buffer, so then we're going to instruct our code to say that we need to capture our demo video right over here. So we're going to say vid equals cv2 dot video capture. And we're going to specify our demo video to run. Okay, then we're going to say tf li.name equals demo underscore video. And we're going to say dem vid equals open tf li.name and rb. Over here, we're going to read our video. So you can say demo underscore bytes equals dem underscore vid dot read. Next up, we're going to put in the sidebar. We're going to say specify the text. So we'll say, okay, this is where you place your input video. And we want to put in our video by saying sd.sidebar.video, and that will be demo bytes. So before we run it, we're going to put in an else statement. So what we're going to do is we're going to copy all of this and paste it down here. So instead of reading our demo video, we're going to delete these first two lines, and then we're going to say tfli.write video underscore file underscore buffer dot read. So essentially what's happening is when we drag and drop a video into the interface, it will load that video instead of the default demo video. Cool, so let's save that. Let's run it over here, see if it works. Cool, so as you can see, we have our drag and drop interface. I can go over here and drop our sample video right there. It will load it up and it will display the input video right over here. Simple, right? Cool, so next up, what we're going to do is we're going to just simply print, just for debugging purposes, tfli.name. So we can see in console if we've gotten our video. So that's sd_frame equals sd.empty. Here we're going to put a markdown. This we can just copy and paste from here. Cool, so now that we have our divider over here, we can put other things below if we wanted to. I think we should put another one right over here. So let's just copy this and put it right below our checkboxes. Save that, refresh. I think that looks much neater. What do you think? Okay, so moving on, we're going to put in our KPIs. So we're going to have KPI 1 or KPI 1, KPI 2, KPI 3, and we're going to say sd.columns We're gonna create three columns. Save and refresh. So right now you won't see anything because we haven't stated what should be in those columns. Just empty columns right now. So the way we do that is we're gonna say width KPI 1. We're gonna say sd.markdown. We're going to specify our frame rate for the first one. So put in 4 stars there, and in between there we're going to say frame rate. The double stars are to specify that we want it to be bold. Don't forget our quotation marks there. And then we're also going to put another text here that we're going to change. That's KPI1 underscore text. We want that text to equal sd.markdown, and we want that to be 0. We want all of them to be initiated with 0. So let's copy this, paste one over here and another over here. This one will be KPI2 and KPI3. This will be tracked objects. And the final one will be width. And now you don't have to stick with these standard KPIs that I have over here. You can make it whatever you want. So maybe the total of all the tracked objects, or you can make it how many cars are going north or how many cars are going south. You can even convert this into a graph at a later stage. So you can make these KPIs whatever you want into whatever analytical component that you feel is relevant. I'm just specifying these three because frame rate is important. Tracked objects, you want to know how many tracked objects there are in your scene. Width is, say if you have a different video, you want to know why it's performing so slow. Maybe it's because you got a 4K video. And maybe if you have a standard definition or SD image, you'll see that it'll maybe run faster. What you can also include is maybe car count. So you can put across a line, like how we'll do in the pro apps of this course, where you put a line and you'll count all the cars that come into the line. But we'll focus on that in future modules. For now, let's just stick with these three KPIs. So if you save this and refresh, you can see that it's looking a bit bland. We'll spice it up in just a moment. But right now you can see we have frame rate, tracked objects, and width. Cool, so as you can see that we are almost done. The main thing that we need to do right now is to enable YOLO R for object detection and also DeepSort for tracking. And then display our video over here. Now this is very simple, we just require one line of code for all of this. And why we've done it like this is because you can create your user interface on this script over here, and all of your YOLO R stuff will be in its own YOLO R script over here, including DeepSort. So let's finish up. So we're gonna say load underscore YOLO R. It's a YOLO R and process each frame. So if we go over here, let's look for it. It's this one over here. So it requires a couple of arguments. In this case, we need the name of the video. We need to decide whether to enable GPU, our confidence, the assigned class ID, our KPIs that we want to track, as well as our streamlet frame. Okay, so over here we're gonna put in tfly.name. We want to enable our GPU if the checkbox is checked. We also want to input our confidence. Now the reason why it's giving some errors is because of our indentation. Make sure that you properly indent all of the lines of your code. That's confidence. We also want to put in our assigned class ID. Let's just make this a bit smaller so we can fit in everything. We're going to put in our KPI 1. KPI 2. KPI 3. Now this is also the text. So don't forget text. Because our text is changing, not the headings. And then we want to put in our ST frame. Now the reason why it's giving an error over here is because we totally forgot to change this. So from KPI 1 to KPI 2, this will be KPI 3. So that should remove all our errors. Let's just write over here that we are calling YOLR. And processing all of our frames. Cool, next we're gonna say once video is complete, we're gonna give a text saying that video is processed. Then once video is complete, we want to release our video by saying vid.release and then parentheses. Great, so that is the code in under 100 lines or less. Now there's one thing that is missing. Let's see if we can spot it. So I'm going to refresh. So let's cancel this over here and save. Let's rerun our script. Cool, so as you can see, we have our video that's been displayed, right? If we enable the GPU, you can see that everything will run just a bit more faster. As you can see how it is right now. We're detecting vehicles, the cars are moving. It's at a slow 4 to 5 frames per second, but it does the job. We can change to custom classes. So if I want to specify only cars, you can see the truck will display and maybe be detected as a car instead. We can change to person as well. So the last thing that we need to do is to update our frame rate, track objects and width. Let's just cancel this for now. So the way we do that is that we go into our YOLR script, scroll all the way down, and this is where we insert the code for our KPIs. Okay, so what we can do is we can say KPI 1 underscore text dot write. We're going to specify our styling for the text, which will be F. We're going to put in our H1 tags, so this will be H1, so that's heading. Style equals text underscore align with text, or rather text dash align. We want it to be in the center. You can change this obviously to the styling of your choice. Color, we want this to be red so it stands out. And then that should be it for that. Then we add in another set of brackets, putting a pair of these. Let's put in more parentheses or brackets. 1F. So this is specifying the decimal place that we want. So after this, we're going to say dot format FPS, which is our frames per second. That we get right over here. Cool. With that done, we can now close off our H1 tags and save. If we refresh, let's see what happens. Obviously, we have to rerun our app. So we're going to go here, up, streamlit.run, streamlitdemo.underscore base.py. I'm going to enable my GPU. If you don't have a GPU, that's fine, you can run it out the CPU. It'll just be a bit slower. Now you can see that I've not done this correctly. Let's go back and see what happened. So we've got F, we've got our H1 style equals text align, center, we want it to be center, color of red. So over here, we forgot to write comma, unsafe, underscore allow underscore HTML equals true. Okay, save that. Let's refresh. Enable GPU. If it still gives us error, just exit out of here and then just rerun your app. Cool, so there we have it. As you can see that this is in red text, it looks really great. Let's finish up the rest with tracked objects and width. So let's stop this. To save time, we're simply going to copy and paste. Call this KPI 2 and 3. This, we're going to delete this part over here. And we're going to specify the length of our data queue. Or data DQ. So data underscore DQ is essentially the number of tracked objects that we kept in our queue. And finally, we just want to put in over here, we're going to specify the width. Width comes from over here, where it gets the number of pixels or the resolution from our OpenCV cap underscore prop dot frame width. You can specify the height as well if you want to. Cool, so let's save that and refresh. Hopefully we should be done. Now when you get something like this and it doesn't show up, make sure you exit, quit, and rerun. I'm going to enable GPU. And there we have it. As you can see, everything is running as it's supposed to. We can change our confidence. We can save the video. We can also use custom classes. So I can specify cars. I can browse and put in my own file. So I'll go to sample, drag and drop it over here. And this is just amazing because, I mean, we are filtering by person, but let's say we want to filter by maybe handbags. Handbags. Take out people and we want to put in maybe suitcases as well and also backpacks. So let's see what this looks like. As you can see, a couple of people do have handbags and backpacks. So this is quite useful in the case of airport security. So pat yourself on the back because we've just created a YOLOR object detection and tracking dashboard using Streamlit. Great, so homework for this lecture. So instead of using a pre-trained YOLOR model, what I would want you to do right now is to, instead of using a pre-trained YOLOR model, is to insert your custom YOLOR model and just take a screen recording of your YOLOR dashboard in Streamlit, put in some key analytics or KPIs that you feel are relevant to your specific application, and post it right over here in the OpenCV AI group. And then once you have done that, scroll down and to comment on other people's projects that they have posted. Now your comment can be either a comment that can state good job on completing the project, or maybe give some feedback as to how they can improve on it, if you feel that it's necessary. Great, so now you know how to implement YOLOR with Streamlit. If you made some mistakes along the way, you can head over here to this folder that says scripts, and you can simply copy and paste these two back into the main folder. But if you got everything right the first time, then great job. And I'll see you in the next lecture. So now that you have built your Streamlit dashboard using YOLOR, now what if you want to get facial landmark detection working in Streamlit? Well, click on this thumbnail and you'll be able to develop it right now.